This is the first time in my career as an artist, and possibly the last time, that everybody in the world is going through the exact same thing at the exact same moment in time. So for comedy, the setup is gone. The context is gone. We can now have the most open conversation we've ever had in our life. The only solution is really more comedy. You have to keep doing jokes until everybody realizes these are just jokes. And newsflash, the political joke is the easiest joke in the world. It really is, because 50% of your audience is going to laugh irrespective of the joke, just by how they feel about the politician. There's nothing terribly clever about a political joke, you know. Now, can you disguise the political joke? Can you make it clever? Can you make it relatable? Can you write a political joke that the 100% laugh at? You know, whatever wing you're in, that to me is a challenge. But I don't think there's anything terribly imaginative or courageous about a political joke.
Welcome to this chat with one of India's best-known comic artists, Veer Das. We are here today because Veer is starting a show on 21st August called Inside Out. It is the only comedy special that has been recorded during the lockdown.
That's the toughest thing about this virus, is like we don't know who to blame. Like, this is the first thing we've experienced in the last 73 years that is not Pakistan's fault. We are not used to things not being Pakistan's fault.
All right, what's up, everyone? Hello.
Veer, I'll begin by asking you to tell me just a little bit about Inside Out. It intrigued me because, you know, when I heard that I had to do this interview with you, one of the things I was going to ask you was, you know, that stand-up comedy thrives on that moment when you crack the joke and then the applause and the laughter comes through, and you know, and you must be missing that a lot. And then I find that you've come up with this amazing format. So please tell us about that.
Well, I kind of stumbled onto it. I'll be very honest. It wasn't orchestrated in the least. When the lockdown began, I was trying to raise money for different charities. And we started doing these online Zoom shows. And, you know, 250, 350 people would buy tickets and you're on Zoom. And every night we'd give away between 1 lakh and 2 lakhs to a different charity. So we did 35 shows for different charities. But Zoom shows are terrible and there's a lag and, you know, you're not there. And that cooking is not there. I think of stand-up comedy as live cooking. And so that you don't feel like you're in the kitchen cooking anything. So just to kind of placate the audience and to warm them up, I started making conversation. And I said, hey, what's the first thing you want to do once the lockdown ended? And really, because people were all so collectively vulnerable, they started giving you really, really honest answers. And I was like, oh my God, there's a conversation here. And then people from different countries started tuning in. So I'd get people from Wuhan and I'd get people from South Africa and from Poland and, you know, from Costa Rica, because they heard that this show has this conversation. And I started extending that segment of the show because I just had this realization that this is the first time in my career as an artist, and possibly the last time, that everybody in the world is going through the exact same thing at the exact same moment in time. That's never happened before. You know, barring maybe World War II, this has never happened before. So for comedy, the setup is gone. The context is gone. We can now have the most open, and your nationality didn't matter anymore. I had a girl in New York saying, I'm dying to get my eyebrows done and I'm too scared to do them myself. And a girl in Wuhan going, I feel you, girl, same thing. I'm in exactly the same boat. So it just turned into, that's what it is. It's 68 different stories from across the world and people talking about their dreams in a pandemic. What that did for me as an artist was I had to be open to the audience setting the tone of the conversation. After 15 years of making it about me the whole time, I have to go and going, okay, now you will tell me what we're talking about. And that's the show.
That's lovely. I mean, it's very interesting. It sounds almost like, I mean, I know it's not perfect, but it sounds like a very good via media at a time when you can't have a live audience. It's almost like you're performing individual, you know, sort of talking, have individual tracks with every one of your listeners. And I found that really interesting. Despite that, how much have you really missed the live audience, and how have you coped with this time, these very strange times?
You know, I'm used to this is the first time in my life that I haven't shot anything and I haven't toured anywhere in over 4 months. So for me, that's extremely strange. But you also, what it's done for me is this, and this is my perspective on it. Fortunately or unfortunately, I've coming in as an outsider, I've had to kind of self-produce, self-write or self-create 90% of the stuff that I've been in. You know, I've kind of had to put it together myself. So when you do that for the bulk of your career, you're used to being in charge and you're used to having a certain control, you know, or you're used to having the wheel and navigating the wheel. And for the first time, I'm learning that there's certain things you cannot control and you have to accept them. So that's what it's done for me. You know, that's been frustrating to say, I'm not in charge of when I can do a show again. What do you mean? I'm not in charge of when I can shoot again. Some vaccine maker and some president is in charge of when I can do another show. This sucks. So that's been the struggle for me, is letting go of control.
But I also noticed that it's giving you some fun material for your shows. For instance, you said that this is possibly the only problem we can't blame Pakistan for.
Yeah, I mean, that is refreshing, but it's also, that is the hallmark of being Indian also at some level. Now, it's before we solve it, we will solve it. We'll solve it in 15 minutes, but we'll spend the first 15 minutes blaming somebody for it. Before we need to know who to blame before we find a solution. Not that the accused has anything to do with the solution whatsoever. And usually our go-to guy is Pakistan, and he's just not there anymore for us in this one. I feel like he dropped the ball.
Yes, I know. I feel too that we know we're missing excuses. But Veer, what did you do on August 15th? Did you eat paneer?
I did not eat paneer. What did I do on August 15th? My wife and I watch Gandhi. It's very cheesy, but we'll watch Gandhi every August 15th. So we've seen that movie every year together for 15 years. So we'll do that. And I was editing this show. You know, it's that's basically what I was doing all of 15th August, largely.
Right. I'm truly impressed. You know, that sounds like a very patriotic thing to do, watching Gandhi on August 15th.
And it's more of a recollection to childhood. I think I watched it with my parents thrice, and then you can't see your parents. You kind of feel like, you know, it's like your family is doing something together. So yeah.
Absolutely. I want you to get a little bit of sense about some of the things that are happening in the world right now, and what Veer Das might say about such stuff. So can you tell me how you're responding to Kamala Harris's nomination for VP? Are you also adopting her as one of our own? We've been very quick to adopt her as our own. And sitting here in Chennai, of course, you know her Chennai background. What's Veer Das got to say about this?
Well, I think not only have you guys adopted her as one of your own, she's adopted you as one of her own as well. You know, it's a two-way street, because we're a very large vote bank, and I think she's a very smart lady as well. I hope we can look beyond her nationality to her policy as well, because I think she's going to be president. I don't think of her as a vice president. You know, I think she has a real shot at being president of the United States, not in this election, but the next one. So I'm going to be keeping like a heavy eye on how much she as a vice president can influence policy decisions in the next 4 years, should they win. Because I think she might legit be the first female president of the United States. I think that's going to happen. You know, if not her, then I have to wait for AOC to grow up, 10 years from now. So I'm hoping she cracks it.
Yeah, I know, quite something. If she makes it honestly will be quite something. But talking of Kamala, you know, also brings us to a certain kind of political atmosphere that is prevalent across the world today. I mean, not just India, across the world. And how difficult is life going to be for stand-up comics as we go along the way?
As difficult as you allow it to be, you know, within the constraints of the law. I want to clarify that, right? So when people are threatening your life, or when people are, you know, threatening to break down your comedy club, etc., that's an escalation that is usually out of the ordinary. Let's be honest. You know, a comedy club is not being broken down every week. You know, in the week that Agrima and myself and about five people, we all got death threats solid for a week. That was the first time that happened to us. You know, we've all been gigging for a while before then. But in terms of the atmosphere dictating what your content is, the only solution is really more comedy. You have to keep doing jokes until you realize, until everybody realizes these are just jokes. And I don't think, the way I always talk about it to comedians whenever we vent to each other is, the only battleground we have is an artistic battleground. We can't fight them on power. We can't fight them on amplification. We can't fight them on traction. We can't fight them on budget. All you can really do is write a damn good joke about them or the situation, whoever they are. And that's the only thing that pushes the needle, and that's the only thing that changes the narrative. So that's what you've got to buckle down and do, is just more comedy and more comedy. That's it.
Very true, Veer. In many ways, I feel that perhaps comedy is actually the only thing that's left for us. You know, I saw that little sketch you did with when the Chinese apps were banned, where there was not a single word that you said which, yeah, you know, was you know, out of line, and yet just with your gestures and the things that you were doing on camera, it was like completely, you said so much more. And I really found that subtle approach very, very refreshing. And is that something you work for? Is it something that you strive towards, you know, trying to understate things as much as possible?
I like it when you can't see the joke coming. I like surprising you a little bit, you know, so I do like having a mix of being clever and funny. I'm not going to lie. You know, I like the fact that, I wasn't expecting a joke about the Jungle Book to go into politics, etc. But I'm also cognizant of the fact that the God joke or the political joke in an hour of comedy is five jokes. That's really it. You know, we're right now painted with this narrative that comedians are doing nothing but political humor and nothing but religious humor. And newsflash, the political joke is the easiest joke in the world. It really is, because 50% of your audience is going to laugh irrespective of the joke, just by how they feel about the politician. There's nothing terribly clever about a political joke. You know, now can you disguise the political joke? Can you make it clever? Can you make it relatable? Can you write a political joke that the 100% laugh at? You know, whatever wing you're in, that to me is a challenge. But I don't think there's anything terribly imaginative or courageous about a political joke, to be honest with you. We're all doing it. It's fine. Much like politicians are joking about each other, you know.
Having said that, as a comic artist, what is out of bounds for you? What would you not joke about? Are there things like that? Or do you belong to the school which says that everything is up for a laugh?
I'm of the school of thought that says you're the audience and you define where the line is. So how about I do the joke and you let me know? That's it. I think that's the way I approach it. I'm still going to write the joke. I'm still going to do the joke. And if it completely crosses the line, you'll probably let me know in 1 millisecond. You know, there's nothing worse than silence from an audience. There's nothing worse than an audience letting you know that that wasn't a good joke. And you will have that happen to you every 20 jokes or 30 jokes as a comedian. And that's the line.
So, for instance, you know, the lot of controversy, for instance, about, you know, the rape jokes and how women are expected to have a sense of humor when such jokes are cracked, or certain kinds of racist jokes where people say, hey, come on, it was just a fun thing, you know. So I always find myself, you know, with mixed feelings about this. So I wanted to know from a comic person, from a stand-up comics perspective, is it like some things that you're careful about, or is it just, what is it? If you would explain that a little bit.
I think that this is possibly the only art form where, irrespective of what your morality is or your politics is or your belief system is, somebody is a representative for you. You know, if you're a right winger, there's a right wing comic. If you're a left winger, there's a left wing comic. If you're an Islamophobe, there is an Islamophobe comic. You know, if you're a homophobe, there's a homophobic comic. If you're a woke comic, if you're open to everything, a liberal comic, that exists as well. All of you have that. Unfortunately, when you take jokes that, maybe the word I'm looking for is shake a moral compass, shake a wide moral compass, you pay the price in that you are relegated to a very small group of people who have that twisted morality. Your room of your audience just gets smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller until you die out. So let's say you enjoy rape jokes. You're now performing for 4% of the world. That is severely messed up in the head. You're no longer performing for 96% of the world. And on that 4%, you're not going to have a career that survives very long. You know? So it's kind of democratic in that sense. Comedy kind of takes care of itself. If you're doing racist jokes, you're performing for just racists. And racists, right now, we can say run a fair portion of the world, but eventually the world comes around and racists kind of get put in their place as well. So I do believe that that feeds itself, you know? So if you want to learn and sponge and grow to the widest possible crowd that you can get to, which is what makes you a better artist, you've got to write a wide array of jokes. They can't be about prejudice and they can't be about hatred. You're just minimizing the room. You won't grow.
That's very interesting. I like the idea of the broad-based, you know, sort of jokes. But does this slot you as a nice guy? Is that something you would like to be known as?
Not at all. I think if you see my comedy, it's far from, you know, and it also depends on where I'm at as an artist as well. You know, some specials are, you know, the last Netflix special was very nostalgic and very sweet, but edgy. Special before that, I was just in an angrier place, and that's an angrier special. And you know, you're allowed that as an artist. I think something that we have to, you know, take cognizance of is Dave Chappelle, George Carlin, Eddie Murphy, Chris Rock, Johnny Lever, Anupam Kher. These gentlemen are the best that they have ever been on stage. George Carlin, of course, has passed away, but they're 30, 35 years in. It takes 20 years to really get good at stand-up. I'm 14 years in, and I'm one of the guys who's been doing it the longest. So in terms of India, we're all kids. None of us have found our voice yet. The comedian I'll be a year from now will be remarkably different from who I am right now. It'll have nothing to do with who I am right now. So we're babies. We're all kind of evolving right now, as audience members and as comedians.
But then the genre itself is very, very new. The idea of the stand-up show is very new in India.
Within the English space, yes, but within the Hindi space, it couldn't be older. From Behrupias to Hasya Kavis to Shires to, you know, that tradition of sitting in front of a king, yes, and pulling the king down with humor, that's a uniquely Indian thing and possibly first an Indian thing, you know?
You always perform in English, or do you?
Yes. Yeah.
You're most comfortable in that.
Yeah, I think in English. I act in Hindi all the time, but I think in English. So I write stand-up in English.
We've spoken so much about the sensibility of the comedian. But how? What would you say about Indian audiences? Have we got a sense of humor? Are we discovering a sense of humor? What is it about us? Sometimes I think we're quite short on it, but yeah, what do you say?
You know, there's no uniform sense of humor, especially for a country like India. And comedy is so subjective. So I think we have a sense of humor. We're just learning the protocol for that sense of humor. I think that's where I'd say we are at. We're learning that, oh, there can be jokes I don't like. And I don't have to get upset at them. You know what I mean? You know, it's just, I can just move on and find jokes that I do like. You know, or that if I went and saw a comedian online, I don't have to write him an email. Or I don't have to call the cops. Or I don't have to start a Twitter hashtag. I can just be like, "Acha, acha nahi laga yaar." Much like a Bollywood movie, we know kuch achhi honge, some will be bad, some will be good. Not all singers and songs are good songs. We're getting there with humor. The thing that I think it's always about, and I spoke about this today as well, is it's male ego. India is still very, very driven by male ego, entitled male ego, and this alleged alpha male is very upset by things that he doesn't understand and cannot tolerate a world paradigm that has things out of his box. So he's just learning. That's all I think it is.
This alpha male that you speak of, he also makes life very difficult for women stand-up comedians, doesn't he? How are they coping? What do you say? What do you have to say about how life is for them?
I can't speak to how life is for them simply because my experience has been probably 50 times easier than theirs. You know, the you know, the limits to my access are not as much as they have, etc., etc. I can only speak of when I speak to my friends, and it's a bloodbath out there, and it's terrible from what they tell me. But I've never seen anybody deflate the male ego like a really good female comedian. That's the one thing I've learned from female comedians, is that a really good joke can destroy the most powerful man if it's a killer joke. So we've got amazing female comics in India. We just don't have a very good entry system and a very good support system for them to get into comedy. But right now, you know, if you look at Aditi, if you look at Uruj, if you look at Radhika Vaz, if you look at Bharti Singh on TV, there's great talent. I just hope it gets to like 100 more, you know?
I think possibly that's the reason they get that hostile response, isn't it? Because the male ego can't stand a woman cracking a joke, which deflates that male ego or whatever.
But isn't it the same for actresses who are outspoken? Isn't it the same for female musicians who are outspoken, female influencers who are outspoken as well? It's the same inherent alpha male kind of behavior, you know, which is very convenient for me to talk about, having never been an alpha male ever. I think having severe lack of confidence in all manly issues has finally paid off in this slightly woke world. But it's been tough for a while. So, yeah.
So, what's it like for your wife to live with a stand-up comedian? Does she have to put up with his jokes all the time?
No, I think sometimes she knows me enough to know that I'm not funny in real life. And that's a different guy up on stage. But she also knows me enough to know that, you know, sometimes we'll have a fight or an argument and she'll see me being pensive and she'll go, okay, this is going to wind up in your show, isn't it? And I'll say, yes, absolutely it is. So we're full disclosure in that everything is material and you have to be okay with that. And she's been really supportive with the fact that, you know, it's like dating a circus performer. You have to go where the work is. So I travel 6-7 months a year. That's not easy to deal with. So she's been tremendous with that. So full credit to her.
How does one deal with trolls? And I know that, you know, comedians are targeted quite a lot, as much as possibly other professions, but comedians quite so. How does one, and what are your own sort of dealing mechanisms?
It's such a small portion. Let's first make a distinction between trolls and threats, because those are two very different things. So threats, you must deal with immediately by tagging the authorities. If you feel unsafe, calls to violence, all of that stuff, immediately contact the authorities. Trolls, let it go. You know, if you extend yourself the freedom to talk about whatever, if I want to crack a joke about the Prime Minister or Mukesh Ambani or Saddam Hussein or Adolf Hitler or Satan, I go ahead and do it without thinking twice about it. Why would I not grant an audience member the same feedback system to say anything that he wants without thinking twice about it? You just kind of have to, if it's funny, acknowledge it. And if not, move on. Most of this world isn't on social media. Most of your ticket buyers are not on social media. That's not the world you have to live in.
So social media is just one of the byproducts that you sort of use, or a byproduct of the profession.
And social media also evolves. Right now, social media is the tantrum space. Basically, we're all scared. It's a pandemic. We've all been stuck at home for 4 months. None of us know that our futures are secure. And all the people who we live with are done putting up with our shit. They're officially done with dealing with us and have zero Fs to give about anything that we are going through. So now we're throwing all of our tantrums on social media. So because our family members don't want to deal with us anymore and our spouses don't want to deal with us anymore. So now we're going on social media very angrily and waxing eloquent and angry about everything. It's a tantrum, is basically what it is.
Tell us a little bit about this very, very minimalist wardrobe that you have suddenly adopted during the lockdown. What's it all about? Marie Kondo type of thing, is it?
Not really. It came from a much more simple thing where I've done two world tours in my life, been privileged enough to do it in the last 5 years. The first world tour, I made the mistake of just taking luggage and buying souvenirs everywhere that I went. And because tours are so quick, I ended up seeing zero cities and I ended up spending a lot of money that I didn't need to. And that was 28 countries. On this world tour, I was doing 34 countries. And I set myself a challenge saying, can I do the world tour with only carry-on luggage, with no check-in luggage? So can I go to 34 countries without checking in a suitcase? And that meant I needed 4 underwear, 5 t-shirts, 1 sweater, 2 pairs of shoes, 1 to work out in, 1 to go in this thing. And the rule was, I'm not going to buy new clothes, I'm not going to buy souvenirs, but I'll fly myself first class, I'll stay in a suite, I won't stay in a regular room, and I'll eat in the best restaurant when I get to town. So all this money I would have spent on shopping, I'm going to spend on these things. And I found myself actually seeing the world, you know, taking in a city, discovering new things, because I wasn't lugging luggage, this, that. Airport time was reduced to 10 minutes, 15 minutes. It just changed the way. And then when the world tour ended, I was like, yeah, I'm just going to continue living like this because it's easier.
So you're saying this is not just your lockdown wardrobe. You're going to carry on like this?
I mean, yeah, it's been the last year of my life has been this. I should mention, when I put up the post about my minimalism, my wife went and ordered me 5 t-shirts on Amazon. So now I've gone from 5 to 10 t-shirts. She had a point to prove, saying, how can you show people you have such a minimal wardrobe? You look like you don't have any money. So I got 5 t-shirts suddenly came in from H&M or something. But yeah, it's easier. And when Shivani and I travel, we get to really have a good time. So our rule is music, books, experiences, food, hospitality. Spend any amount of money on these 5 things. But, you know, we don't need a Louis Vuitton bag as such.
That's a lovely travel philosophy. I completely approve of that. I was very fascinated. I have always been fascinated by your beginnings in acting. You know, was that a career that you seriously considered and then left midway? How did that work out? And do you still want to go back? Will you go back full time to acting at some point?
It'll never be full time. It'll always be a healthy mix of the two, because I don't think I could do either for the whole year. You know, I don't think I could be comedy is a very solitary profession. You know, I couldn't be in airports and hotels without collaborating with other artists for 52 weeks. And also, I very honestly could not hang out with actors for the entire year. There's only so much I can talk about protein shakes and push-ups and, you know, diets, etc., etc. So I can't be in a vanity van my entire year either. So it's nice to have a healthy mix of the two. I started out wanting to do drama, to do theater, and primarily wanting to teach theater. So I wanted to be a drama professor, and, you know, and to teach Shakespeare and do that. And that's why I joined those acting programs. And then I discovered stand-up comedy and kind of stumbled into acting as well. And now I love doing 1, maybe 2 acting projects per year and a large tour every year. That's what I like.
Veer, have you done theater since in India? Have you done any serious theater?
No, but because theater takes a while, you know, it's 8 weeks of rehearsal and then a long run, etc. And the kind of theater that I enjoy, India doesn't do so much of, you know. Theater tends to be little, there's no word for it, but just that's the only expression that I can think of. It's very like tanhai and serious and cerebral. But if you look at some of the great plays or West End plays or even some Russian plays, it's funny and it's great and it's entertaining. So maybe someday we'll see.
What was Edinburgh Fringe like? What was the experience? Tell us a little bit about that.
It's my happiest place of the year, because you start out with, you know, 20, 30 people in the audience. And then if you're not good, you'll end with 4 people in the audience after 30 days. And if you're good, you'll end with 150 people. And you can take a show that isn't fully complete and put it together in Edinburgh. You'll have a show at the end of the festival. And for me, it's just consumption. There are 30,000 performances in 30 days, you know, and artists from everywhere in the world. So it's like Disneyland for an artist's soul. It really is. It's great. And I meet other Indian comedians. Like, I meet Aditi Mittal and Sumit Anand and all of these guys. I don't have time to meet them in India. They don't have time for me. But in Edinburgh, we sit and talk about life and have a beer. And, you know, it's a really good retreat.
When you mentioned your Indian colleagues, a thought that struck my mind Is there something like an I know, of course, that comedy is very often region specific, jokes are region specific and so on. But is there any particular sensibility that sets aside or sets Indian comics apart from their counterparts in the world in the way in which you do stand up or whatever format that you might work in?
No, I think the world's becoming a very small place right now. It really is. And I found that the more and more I toured the world, the more it became important to tell an authentically Indian story. That was very weird because people are like, "Arey, we've heard about airline food. We've heard about, you know, men don't listen, women don't, you know, we've heard all of this shit. Take us somewhere we haven't been before." That became very important. So just tell your own story, be very authentic in it. So, you know, I feel like that's what African comedians are doing, and East Asian comedians are doing as well, and Arabic comedians are doing. So it's very much even game right now.
So it's very much just speaking about your own life, and that is sort of resonating with audiences abroad. It's what I'm trying to say is there is no sense of disconnect, is it? It's not that they don't understand, you know, what is the peculiarly Indian
situation.
If they don't
understand, I'm happy to explain it to them. You know, it only takes 30 extra seconds. So you find the analogy for what works for them, you know, and it usually works out. But I'd rather do the joke and explain it before, explain the context and then do the joke, than not do the Indian joke. You know, I don't see any point in going to America and just talking about Trump and gun control and, you know, etc. I want to talk about Lajpat Nagar also and explain to you what Lajpat Nagar is.
Yeah, Lajpat Nagar, lovely. You were one of the earliest persons who did the current affairs slot, you know, sort of current affairs programs, which you have then sort of reinvented many times over. Could you tell me a little bit about what it takes to put together a really good current affairs program, which is sharp, which is critical, and at the same time, really, really funny? How do you work at it? How do you get your material and so on?
You need multiple writers. That's the only way, because I feel like really, really sharp shows and really large shows work from multiple perspectives. So you need a very diverse writing room. And that leads to a really, really good show. You know, the secret behind John Oliver or John Stewart, both of whom I hold up there as the best who ever did it, is a really diverse writing room. Correspondents from everywhere in the world. Some amount, at least for John Oliver, of gender equality in the writer's room, etc. Because otherwise, if you're writing shit with like-minded people, chances are you're writing for a smaller group of people. And you're just making each other laugh. And that's 9 times out of 10 what happens with current event shows. Is the comedian and the writer just kind of finding each other funny, and then you're becoming more and more tone deaf as the show progresses to the world that you're writing about.
So the trick is to have a large team and all of the members talk. Is that what you're trying to say? So that it's being...
No, I think maybe not a large team, but have a team that is very diverse in thought and opposing in thought. You know, we did News on the Loose on CNBC years ago. You know, I'm quite liberal in my politics. My boss was quite conservative in his politics. You know, Saurabh, who was on that, was just a kid who was very vulgar and very kind of driven. You know, we had like 6 or 7 people on this. And that clash led to a very good, because then if we all agreed that this was a good joke, chances were it was a very, very good joke. And that made it to the air. That's what I think leads to really, really good news comedy, is disagreement.
News comedy is itself a slightly, should I say, a slightly more sophisticated version of the comic genre, isn't it?
Yeah, I would say no. I would say it's no. Because news comedy is so current, you know, I feel like news comedy is smoking a pack of cigarettes, and stand-up comedy is like a really fine cigar. You know what I mean? That's the only way I can draw an analogy, where the idea of taking a punchline and doing it multiple times until it's just perfect and just honed before you put it on a Netflix. You know, the best Netflix or Amazon specials that you'll see right now The comedians have done that show 100 times. They've re-listened to it and they've reworked on it and tinkered with it and rewritten, etc. And then that shows up on Netflix and Amazon. News comedy, this week, nikal diya, next week kuch aur nikalna hai, next week kuch aur nikalna. It's very, you know, slice and dice, get it out. But stand-up is about honing. So I feel like, as an artist, stand-up is where the game is. News comedy is very much a job. It's a job. So that's why a lot of us don't do it.
I actually thought the exact opposite, that it was the news comedy segments that needed a lot of preparation and stand-up was just, you know, off the cuff and spontaneous. I'm clearly very wrong.
No, it's beer versus blue label, if that's a better analogy. I don't drink whiskey, but, you know, it's beer versus fine wine. You know, fine wine takes time. Beer you can make tomorrow.
All right. So that is excellent insight to, you know, sort of wrap up this show. The fact that you have to work so hard and prepare so much in order to sound so spontaneous. Fantastic, yeah. Veer. It's been a pleasure talking to you.
Thank you.
And I wish you the very best for Inside Out. And I hope that it does really, really well. I'll tune in as well.
Thank you so much. Cheers.